We were continuing towards the west, along the dry desert road. We were now on the last leg of our journey along the Silk Road. Our final destination was the far western town of Kashgar, and from there to the border of China in the Pamirs. The northern and southern routes of the Silk Road pass on either side of the Taklamakan Desert and join up again at Kashgar. It's almost 3,700 kilometers from the old capital of Chang'an, 2,000 miles. And in the old days, just this part of the journey along the Silk Road took more than a whole year. When we arrived in Kashgar, we found it was busy with preparations for a festival to mark the end of Ramadan, the Muslim month of fasting. This is the biggest mosque in the whole of the Western lands, and it was full of the faithful. The so-called Rozu-Je festival at the end of Ramadan is one of the most important in the Muslim year. And many people had come a long way to pray at the mosque. A band took up position on a roof and played cheerful music all day long. In the open space in front of the mosque, people began to dance. But there were only men, because here women don't go to the mosque, and married women aren't allowed to dance in public. A street photographer was doing good business. For only one yuan, or about 60 US cents, you can rent a jacket and necktie, a hat and a pair of sunglasses, and have your picture taken in front of the mosque. People used to hire uniforms to have their photographs taken, but now civilian clothes are more popular. The population of Kashgar is about 200,000, and most of them are Uyghurs. About 70% are Muslims. On that festival day, many people went on praying at intervals until dusk. The people of Kashgar were originally Buddhist, but converted to Islam in about the 10th century. It was the first part of the Western lands to become Muslim. During the 17th century, Kashgar was ruled by a family called Hoja, who claimed descent from the Prophet himself. Their tombs are decorated with beautiful old tiles. In fact, the name Kashgar means the town of beautiful tiles. They tell an old legend about a beautiful woman of the Hoja family. During the 18th century, the Qing Emperor Qianlong wanted a beautiful concubine from the Western lands. He had a search made, and finally one was found for him here. It said that her body exuded a delicate perfume. So when she was brought to Peking, they called her Xiang Fei, or Empress of Fragrance. But she always refused the Emperor's love. His senior wife, the Empress, hated Xiang Fei, and one day, when the Emperor was absent, threatened her with death. Xiang Fei was so lonely that she accepted and died. To the Uyghurs, the Hoja tombs are a holy place, and many people ask to be buried here. Thousand years ago, before the Silk Road was opened, the oasis of Kashgar was called the land of Xu Lu. In the Han Dynasty chronicles, it says that the population of Xu Lu was more than 18,000, and that the country extended as far west as Da Yue Shi, Da Yuan, and Kangju. Da Yue Shi is today's Samarkand, and the other places, also on the old Silk Road, are in modern Soviet Russia and Afghanistan. Kashgar has been for many years a sort of crossroads where people from the east and west mingle together. We visited a kindergarten school for non-Chinese children. Here the children learn to read and write the Uyghur language and simple counting. The boys begin sports and the girls a little housekeeping. I'm 9 years old. I'm an Uzbeki. He's four. He's a Tajik. That child is a Hui. My name is Saptor, and I'm a Kyrgyz. Lucidin, an Uzbeki. Ensiden, 5 years old, an Uzbeki. Migmijan, 3 years old, another Uzbeki. I'm a Uyghur. My name is Tony Sakar. Mayla, Kyrgyz. Mehpari, a Uyghur. In the town, there are three permanent markets or bazaars. Small shops with a frontage of only 2 or 3 meters line the streets, and there are many open-air stalls. On Sundays, the whole town seems to be full of stalls. From the stores, which are selling things like vegetables, household goods and food, you can hear the voices of the shopkeepers. The bazaars of Kashgar have been famous for more than 2,000 years. The Han Dynasty Chronicles mentions them, and it seems that already at that time, the town was full of merchants both from the east and from the west. In one part of the town, you can find many craftsmen stores, which are also workshops. Here's a woodworker spinning a primitive lathe by means of a bow held in his right hand. He's turning a leg for a cradle. He uses wood from poplar and mulberry trees, both of which grow plentifully near the oasis. On display are some of his products, rolling pins and a hat rack. That stick on the left will have a tuft of horsehair attached to it and become a duster. A metal worker is making a strong pot out of copper sheeting. But these days, aluminium is becoming more popular than copper. Cotton has been one of the most famous products of this district for more than 2,000 years. This craftsman told us, as he worked, that even today he can only make the best quilts by hand. The back alleys are always filled with strange sounds and smells. In this jewelry shop, they're working with gold and silver. The women of the Western lands all love jewelry and deck themselves with rings, necklaces, and earrings. It's a tradition handed down from the days when they were all still nomads and had to wear their wealth on their bodies. No one seems to know exactly what this red stone is, but they sell for 20 yuan, or about 120 US dollars. These earrings sell for about 50 yuan, or 300 US dollars a pair. If you bring your own coins to make the jewelry out of, you can get it for about half price. This old man has been working as a jeweler for more than 40 years, and the child is his grandson, who's planning to be a jeweler too. Like a true craftsman, the old man is never quite satisfied with his work. This master craftsman makes musical instruments. His children and grandchildren are also learning the ancient craft. His grandson will be the sixth of his line to make instruments. It takes at least 10 years to learn to make instruments like these. They carve the rounded body of the lute by eye, without the help of any measuring device. Only experience can help them in this delicate work. The craftsman is only happy when he's created a fine instrument and can sell it for a good price. Marco Polo came to Kashgar during his travels, and he wrote, "The land of Kashgar is prosperous, and the people have everything they need for a comfortable life. They're mostly craftsmen and merchants who travel in various parts of the world on business." Kashgar hasn't changed much since those days. Towards the end of October, we saw a caravan of trucks arriving in Kashgar, their horns blowing. It came from Gilgit, in a part of Kashmir which is in Pakistan, beyond the Pamirs. 17 of these trucks, filled with the produce of Gilgit, had come 700 kilometers, 400 miles over the Pamirs in 4 days. During the Tang Dynasty, Gilgit was called Xiaobolu. The truck road is quite new, only 11 years old. And before that, from time immemorial, the trade with Kashgar was always by camel caravan. The brilliant decorations on the trucks show scenes and products of the drivers' hometowns in Pakistan. They seem very splendid to us after months of looking at drab Chinese vehicles. Business between Gilgit and the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region is what is called frontier trade, and it's all done by barter, or exchange of goods. The main product they bring from Gilgit is dried fruit and nuts, mostly almonds, peanuts and apricots. But they also bring nylon scarves, herbal medicines and other small products. The goods to be sent to Gilgit are already stored in the warehouse. There are tools like hammers and pliers, thermos flasks, lamps, ceramics and tea. But the main product for barter is, as it's always been, silk. Silk has always enchanted people from the West. Fine. A welcome party for the truck drivers was given under a pergola in the public park. They're singing an old song about the famous dark-eyed Kashgar girls, skilled at singing and dancing. They encourage the Pakistanis to dance too.
Yeah.
Two men begin a comic dance. The dance made us realize that the men of Gilgit and the Uyghurs have much in common. Thirteen hundred years ago, a Chinese priest crossed the Pamirs just like the driver's hat. His name was Xuan Zhang, and he was on his way home from India. But when Xuan Zhang stopped here, he found several hundred Buddhist temples. He wrote that all the people of this country were Buddhists. There were more than 1,000 priests, and these Buddhist caves on the outskirts of Kashgar, at a place called San Xian Dong, have been here since long before Xuan Zhang's day. They're the most westerly Buddhist remains in China, and they're also the oldest. They were built 200 or 300 years BC and are far older than the caves at Dunhuang. But all the murals and images inside have been destroyed, either by floods or by Muslim iconoclasts. And today there's almost nothing left to give us a hint of what the caves originally looked like. But it's certain that the Kashgar Buddhas provided comfort and strength for many people who had made the hard journey across the Pamirs. We continued westwards, following Xuan Zhang's route, and started on the road for the Pamir Plateau. The old road began at Kashgar, and is said to have passed through the Tashkurgan oasis. In the valley of the Kaidu River, the bare earth often shows. For sometimes in the flood season of June and July, when the snow melts on the mountain, the road is destroyed by rushing water. All the year round, there's the danger of falling rocks. As we climbed higher, the temperature fell. In Kashgar, it had been over 30 degrees Celsius, 80 degrees Fahrenheit, but 4 hours later, it was only 15 degrees Celsius, 60 degrees Fahrenheit. On the road, we saw nomads from Gilgit herding their sheep.
Thank you.
They were bringing their herds of sheep, horses, and yaks that they fattened on the mountain pastures down to the plains for the winter. From here to the north live the Kyrgyz tribe, who are often mentioned in histories of the Silk Road as savage people. In the 9th century, they conquered the local civilized Buddhists and carved out an enormous nomad empire from Lake Baikal in the east to the Taras River in the west. In the Persian language, Pamir means the roof of the world. It's a gigantic plateau between three great mountain ranges, the Hindu Kush, Tien Shan, and Karakoram. After the plateau, there's a high area at about 3,000 meters or 10,000 feet. But many of the mountain passes are at 4,000 or 5,000 meters, 14 or 15,000 feet. So we all had to have cardiographic examinations. And we were only allowed to travel as long as we carried oxygen tanks. In ancient China, the Pamirs were called Kongling. They believed that the plain formed a division between the east and the west. According to the Han Dynasty Chronicle of the Western Lands, after you cross the mountains of great and small headaches and the red fever hills, you suffer from vomiting brought about by the exhalation of poisonous gases. This results in fever and pallor, and even the donkeys suffer. In the past, it took a whole month to travel across Kongling. Xuanzang had a lot of trouble here. He was attacked by robbers, the merchants he was traveling with abandoned him, and his elephants sank into the marshes with their precious sutras still on their backs. These passes are always snowy, and the blizzards blow fiercely. Following in the ancient footsteps of Xuanzang, we finally reached an altitude of 5,000 meters, or 15,000 feet. The air is so thin at this height that you gasp for breath, and many people suffer from headaches. You can't boil water properly, and no one feels like eating. And neither camels nor horses are any use so high up. Yaks are the only beasts that are any good. In the past, caravan masters used to stick skewers into the foreheads of their yaks and mules to keep them going. Perhaps it worked by lowering their blood pressure a bit. Animals that died here became food for the wolves, and travelers used their whitened bones as landmarks. The road across the Pamirs was opened up by the sacrifices of many people. In the middle of the Pamirs, we met quite unexpectedly with a troop of mounted men carrying rifles. They were a local militia. We had entered the Tashkurgan Tajik Autonomous Region, and we'd wandered by accident into the Tajik Militia Training Grounds. The autonomous area has foreign countries on three sides, the Soviet Union, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. Since the outbreak of hostilities in Afghanistan, the militia had not been allowed to shoot their rifles, even with blank rounds, to avoid any appearance of provocation. We could all sense a feeling of tension. The soldiers had long noses and deep-set features and were obviously different from any people we'd met so far on the Silk Road. They had truly Western-looking faces. The language of the Tajik people is a member of the Indo-European family. Tashkurgan Oasis is an open valley about 3,600 meters above sea level, 12,000 feet. On the outskirts of the town is a huge old castle. The name Tashkurgan means a tower of stone. And already during the Han Dynasty, soldiers were sent here. During the Tang Dynasty, a military headquarters was established at the castle. For this was China's front line on the west. The Greek geographer Ptolemy wrote that a Macedonian merchant had told him that to get to the silk country of Cyrlika, he meant China, you had to travel through the country of Tore Sulapedia, which means stone tower in Greek. Many Greek merchants must have passed this way in caravans organized by Persians during the Han and Tang dynasties. When we got to the main street of Tashkurgan, it was quite silent, perhaps because most of the nomads, who sow grain in the spring and come down from the mountains in autumn to harvest it, had not yet returned. Xuan Zhang rested here for 20 days on his return journey from India. He wrote many legends about the building of the town when he was here. One of these legends was about a Persian king who sent a messenger to China to bring him back a wife. The messenger brought a princess back with him, but in the Pamirs they found there was a war going on. The messenger put the princess in a tower at the top of a mountain and guarded her day and night. When the war was over and they could travel again, the princess was found to be pregnant. The messenger was aghast, but a maidservant told him that a god had come from the sun every day to see the princess. Her child could make the winds blow and the clouds move. And when he grew up, he became king and brought great prosperity to the land. We filmed a wedding ceremony that took place at Wacha, about 80 kilometers or 50 miles from Tashkurgan. The groom is the young man with the red and white silk bands on his hat. The red symbolizes butter and the white, milk. Two colors that are used here for celebrations. The groom visits the house of his bride-to-be on the third day of the festivities. He's only 20 years old. The groom is greeted by a group of women who offer him a cup of ewe's milk with salt in it and sprinkle him with flour. This is to symbolize plenty. They offer the same to the groom's attendants, but the groom only dismounts from his horse when he is invited to do so by the father of the bride. And he's given permission to enter the house only when his father-in-law-to-be has inspected the presents he's brought. The house is built of sun-dried brick, and it's sunk a little way into the ground. The bride, who's 19 years old, wears the same red and white festival colors as her groom. The village elder talks to the groom's attendants, asking them what the young man has come for and whether he will make his wife happy. The bride and groom never utter a word to each other. The elder reads from the Quran and blesses the happy couple. Then they fill a cup with ewe's milk. The attendant serves the groom with his right hand and the bride with his left.
Ilahi mubarakik aur khair.
The young couple have known each other since they were children. In the old days, people used to get married when they were 15 or 16. But nowadays, they tend to marry at about 20. However, they still marry for love, which is just as it's always been. Outside, they're already dancing to celebrate the wedding. The whole village has been invited. This was the first place we'd seen in China where people kiss in public. The young couple will begin their married life in a room in the groom's family house. There are about 20,000 Tajiks in the Tashkurgan Autonomous Region. But the tribesmen also live across the border in the Soviet Union, in Afghanistan, and in Iran. About 130 kilometers, or 80 miles, from Tashkurgan, we found ourselves near the border with Pakistan. From here, the Silk Road used to go on into Afghanistan, but nowadays the border is closed, even to nomads. A stone to mark the border stands here on the Kunjarap Pass at an altitude of 4,943 meters, 15,000 feet. There's plenty of snow here, but no sign of any people at all. Gilgit is only about 200 kilometers from here, 120 miles, but only a very few people, Pakistani or Chinese, are ever allowed to pass. It was time to say goodbye. These modern travelers on the Silk Road said, "See you next year." And the Silk Road went on through Persia and so to Rome.